Freed's original paper is currently cited thousands of times, showing its massive impact on science. It developed five components of frailty, consisting of the ones we introduced in the first week. They are unintentional weight loss, low grip strength, slow walking speed, fatigue, and low physical activity. But these were assessed in different ways. Unintentional weight loss and fatigue were determined by asking these two questions. And 1 point was scored for each question with a positive answer. Low grip strength and slow walking speed were assessed by measuring them. Grip strength can be measured with a device called a hand grip dynamometer, while walking speed is a matter of timing how long someone takes to walk a preset distance. That means that these two tests actually require equipment and a couple of minutes to explain and perform the test. But in contrast to the yes-no answers for the first two, these two tests do provide continuous scores, so any value is in theory possible. To then determine if someone had a low grip strength or a slow walking speed, a certain cutoff value would be used. If you score below that cutoff value, you would have another point scored in your frailty tally. The final component was low physical activity, and this one was done with a questionnaire, which consisted of various questions that tried to deduce the average amount of energy expenditure per day. This is again a score that's continuous in nature, and again a cutoff value was used. Again, if the score was below it, you'd have another point. The final step is then to add these five scores up. If the sum is three or more, you'd be classified as being frail. Freed also called people with one or two as a score of pre-frailty. This was based on her analysis indicating that this group was different in terms of risk of disability and death, compared to both the frail and the robust group. They were on the path to frailty, so to speak. These days, there is some debate about whether pre-frailty is relevant, but let's not go into too much detail at the moment. In later sections, we will look at these measures in a bit more detail. But the range of types of assessments, even in the original study, already vary from simple questions with yes-no answers to longer questionnaires and actual practical tests. This has also resulted in more than 100 different versions of this phenotype model, all with different variations of the five characteristics in relation to how they're being measured.